It is part two of Wizard in a Bottle, which has nothing to do with Christina Aguilera. Or does it? We may not know. Depends on what's at the end of this dungeon.
I hope so.
If she's there, I mean, she might be there. Let's be honest. It's very possible. If we didn't have such a strict time limit today, she probably would be. But we're probably just going to stick to the module. What I'm doing is I'm running some random modules, which are like pre-written kind of modules. Like they're like they give me the skeleton of a module. We run through that with pretty standard crew this week. What do you got? You got a fighter. You got a druid, a cleric, a sorcerer, and a rogue. And they've headed down into a...
Yeah, and a barbarian.
And a sort of barbarian. Yeah, because...
Don't forget the barbarian.
Gondash is a half-orc sorcerer, level 1 barbarian, level 2 sorcerer, multi-class. The module is called Wizard in a Bottle. Essentially, somebody said, can you go and find my old adventuring partner? 20 years ago, I was in a group of people, and our wizard wandered off once at one point. Went and found a tower, went into the tower, an old sorcerer's tower, and never came out. Can you go and find her? This group said, yep, he disappeared into the ground. Which is nothing, that is just something I made up for the record. Don't think he's going to come back out as like some demonic earth elemental at the end. That's just because this is the first time I've ever run an actual module and it doesn't tell you what happens to him. It just gets to the end of him setting you a task and I think you were supposed to just turn around and leave, but you kept questioning him and I was like, no. And I looked, I was like, well, what do I do if I want him to go away? So I just made him disappear into the ground so that you couldn't speak to him anymore and you'd get on with the fucking task. So... Don't read too much into that, all right? This is what happens when I impose on this module. They went into this tower. In the tower, they've had to deal with spiders, water weirds, dust mephits, and a room full of eyes. I guess we'll go there. We'll go there now. Back to the actual tower itself. And quite frankly, we're just going to carry on. So... Two of the group, Malkai and Valris, ended up fighting two dust mephits in a room which had two big cabinets in it. And the other two, Petrello and Gondash, ended up fighting a water weird in a another room where there was like a pool of water and there was something at the bottom of it. You have questions?
I have to restart my computer.
Why?
Because my mouse stopped working. I can't operate it.
Well, how are you going to restart the computer then without a mouse?
Just
go on in.
Bye.
Do it. Get it done. What was your question, Zod? This is going to mess up the cameras, by the way. So don't worry about it.
I was just holding my hand up because she was.
Oh, I see. So she can't make her own decisions? Is that what it is?
Yeah.
She is the cat's mother, Zod, okay? She has a name, it's Karina, if you wouldn't mind. And personally,
I love the image she's gone out on. Just
I'm really happy it's done that actually, because it means that it doesn't mess the cameras up.
Yeah.
Everybody print screen
don't, please don't.
Karina's face there.
She'll cry.
And send it to her, and because not only has she come
she'll
into
cry.
The game and
cry.
And disappeared 5 minutes into it, but she was 8 minutes late. I was counting. She was actually technically an hour and 8 minutes late.
Yeah, she's the whole reason we're starting now.
Oh, yeah. There she goes.
There it goes.
So ideally, I would like you to make her cry, if that's okay. A counter argument from Zod as to why you shouldn't make her cry.
I like her.
Ooh, why don't you marry her, Zod?
Okay, one day.
No. You heard it here first. Can I be the preacher, the priest, the official?
You can be the bridesmaid.
Alright, everyone but Zod, turn the cameras off. Karina, go. Nora, go. Noodle, go. Team, go. Thunder. Thunder. Thundercats.
Ah! Form of an ice menorah.
Form of... okay. So, let's go. Let's go. You guys are back in this place. Let's start with Petrello and Gondash, since they are on the screen. You've just defeated the water weird, which came up out of this water thing. And as you can hear from that waterfall sound, the water weird is returning.
Some good sound effects from Zod.
Fuck off.
Voice acting.
I killed the children. I can't kill the waterfall.
I'm tempted to buy you a microphone. Just cause
please do.
I just feel... How much is a... What's that piece of crap you've got, Noodle?
Let's look it up now.
Snowball mic. Snowball mic. If it's less than £30, I'll buy it for you. It is £40, so no, I can't.
Oh no,
it's not worth it. It's not worth it because you'll never come back. That's the thing. I'll buy this thing, and then you'll be like, "Oh, I'm busy. I can't play this week. Oh, I'm too busy. I'm too tired because of work to play this week." So I know it's not a worthy investment. If you were in every Saturday, I'd buy you this. This was like £2,000.
Pretty sure, dude.
That's mine then, Brad.
You're not in it every week either.
Am I not, though?
You just keep showing up at my house.
It's true, I do.
You could just take one of the many microphones that is in this house.
It's true.
All right. Go, crew. You are in this room, Gondash and Petrello. The water weird has disappeared to the bottom. That is your column of divine light or whatever, so we don't really need that anymore. You've got a moonbeam. At the bottom of this water, there's a figure, like a body or something, that you were able to work out just before this thing popped out and said hello. I think, Gondash, you saw it.
Yeah, I tried to get it, which is why the weird attacked, right?
Correct. Stop meandering. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, so it's not. It's about. I think I said the water was only a few feet, like, but it was very dark because it's putrid. So it's probably about, let's say, 6 feet in depth. But it's where it's been disturbed, you're able to see a little bit clearer into the bottom of the water. There's just a shape.
You tried to do chilling touch on it, right?
I had a cold hand, and then I put my cold hand in there.
Correct. I remember when that happened.
The thing attacked us.
Yeah.
So, it's a good time.
Do you want to investigate further, or do you just want to leave?
Wait, is the thing still there?
The shape is there, yeah. The like, body.
I don't know it's there, right?
I mean, you can look in there now that this... You've clearly killed this thing. It was you that basically killed it with...
It was 100.
Yeah.
With, like, some moon beam thing.
Saved your ass. I would like to do a perception check. A perception check? Investigation, right?
Investigation and perception will both work, really, in this situation. Whichever one is higher, you are free to do.
Yeah.
Nice! The, at the bottom of this pool, there's definitely a body. It's like 100% it is a body. It's a very small body. It could be a child, but based on the breadth and size and sort of muscles, it's probably more likely to be a halfling. Lightly armored, and there's a sword down there. Looks pretty rusted over, and it does have a very small pack at his side.
I look over at what's his name? Gonorrhea. Mm. Gondash.
That's how it's pronounced.
Look over at Gonorrhea Rash, and I say, "There's a body down here. Come and help me. Help me take it out."
This is what I was reaching for. Did you not see before we were attacked?
No, I didn't. I thought I saw you were searching for something. I didn't realize there was a body down here. Come and help me. You can't leave the body down here that long.
All right. And I just climb in. And I pick it up on my own. And I pick it up on my own.
Yeah, and Petrello, do you help or do you just let him do it?
I try and sort of help as much as I can, but...
You forget I am orc. I have strength. This is small human. I do not need normal... You're human, right?
He's a dwarf, but he's a weak-looking dwarf.
Yeah.
I do not need other small human to help.
I'm pretty sure you'll find I'm a dwarf and that's actually a halfling, but I understand the point. Go on, you take care of that.
Halfling?
Yes, yeah, a halfling.
I tried to pick up the halfling.
All right. Do you get in?
Yeah, I just like fully immerse myself in the water.
Just go on in and lift out this.
I'm 6 foot anyway, so.
Yeah, so is that you could just about get in the water and lift this highly decomposed halfling body out of this putrid water, and you just over the edge and it rolls over. Petrello, you'll see that it was a halfling. Now it's like mostly just decomposed flesh inside a very rusty chainmail. If you bring the sword out, it is a short sword, but it's pretty much useless. It wouldn't smelt down for any money either.
I just take up the halfling.
Gondash needs to give me a constitution check. Okay. So there's a little pack as well. It's only very small. There are a couple of items in there that just destroyed, a couple of pieces of like parchment, bits and bobs. But there is also these items which you two can share amongst you if you'd like to. 30 silver pieces, 53 copper, and a moonstone, which is worth 10 gold pieces if you liquefy it down.
A moonstone, or is it a night? A night fire stone, whatever the fuck it was called.
I mean, it's a moonstone. I have no idea what you're talking about, but it's a moonstone, which is interesting considering you killed the thing protecting this water with a moonbeam. Sign from the gods, some would say. Do you share the money out between you?
Yeah.
Just between
you
two?
Yeah, half and half, I guess.
I give him the larger percentage of copper, which would be 20. He gets 27, I get 26 copper. Have fun with that copper.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
27.
Yeah.
And then...
What about the silver, half and half, right?
Yeah, I get 15, you get 15. You can have the moonstone as well. I hand it to you.
Oh, thank you.
Pretty kind of need for stone.
Do you, do you leave?
Swiftly get out of the water.
Yeah.
this water, it's angry. I do not know who has angered the element. Perhaps halfling.
Yes, perhaps. I'm not sure why else he would have been down there. It's a very strange set of circumstances, isn't it?
Presumably, you guys will be heading back to the other two. The rest of this room is there's nothing in it, really. Nothing of interest. It's just this pool of water, which was possibly once something of importance to the sorcerer, but now pretty much just the grave of a halfling body. Do you just leave the body and stuff?
It's just
a moldy body, isn't it? There's no checking out of it today.
No, you have all the things that were on it of worth, and you can head up towards the other two. So at this point, Malkai and Valoris, let's return to you all the way up here in the other room. So this room was very, very dusty, and two dust mephits came out of the ground, attacked you both. You managed to best them. It was a little bit trying at points. There is the body of somebody else, like highly armored. There are two cabinets as well. Valoris actually moved into this room, the hallway leading a bit further down. But first of all, we'll see how you deal with whatever you're dealing with now. What do you guys want to do just before these two arrive? I know they're there on the map.
I guess check out the body.
I want to go and check out the shells because I think we checked out the body last time, right?
Yeah, you guys did a look over of the body. It was a human who was a cleric of Chauntea, which was the goddess of agriculture.
It had that thing.
Yeah, I think you worked that one out. Rusty chainmail armor again, and the mace had the holy symbol on it. There was a symbol, something around his neck.
It had like a carving, yeah.
And you opened the leftmost cabinet, and I think you took out a skull or something and kept it for yourself.
Like a fossil or something.
Oh, yeah, fossil, yeah.
Worthless.
And then you were attacked, so.
Yeah. Is there anything special about those barrels or something? Because you said there was a smaller one.
Yeah.
Is there anything interesting in there?
So there is two barrels here with like very like small amounts of fetid water in the bottom. But this smaller barrel here appears to be like fairly well sealed. And you pick it up and it's filled with a liquid of some kind. Give me an investigation check.
Just 1 second. How do I do this?
This is just a beer barrel. And the beer is probably okay.
Okay, it's like heavy, can I put it in my backpack or whatever?
It's like a little one like this. It's just like a little,
okay.
like a huge flask or a very small barrel of stale, but okay, unpoisoned beer. And you can take that large flask of stale beer, we'll call it. How about that? Valris?
I want to check out the shelves. Are there any books on them, or do I find any papers, something like that?
Okay, so as you open this one, this has all sorts of things in it again. A lot of it looks like kind of junk. There's dried insects and beetles. There's weird jars that have preserved organs in. There are some rodent and reptile skins, and then there are some like primitive tools and weapons. Again, nothing stands out as being like a big, a golden like thing that you can take and sell on or anything of a great worth.
Nothing, no paper or parchment or anything like that.
Not really. It just seems to be two cabinets full of junk that might be worth a little bit together if you sold both of the contents of this cabinet as a whole to some sort of antique dealer. Individually, they're not really anything of great worth.
Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna close it and then walk over to Marte. What she's doing.
All right. Petrello and Gondash. Enter probably around now. After dealing
a handsome man enters.
A handsome man enters and Petrello.
Oh.
Right. Well, my roll 20 closed itself and I don't know why, so I have to find Darius. There we go.
Hello.
Is the gas still coming or the smell? It didn't smell too great up here.
Yeah, give me a perception check.
Perception.
It doesn't smell good in here. The smell is probably the rotting body.
It still smells bad. Why are we... How are you still in here? How do you cope with this? This disgusting.
I mean, it's not that bad.
It's not good.
No, but I don't want to stay here. So, it's fine. Let's just get moving.
Yes, agreed. Let's move on, shall we?
Did you find anything, or...?
You found dead, what did you... You called it a halfling?
A halfling, yes.
A halfling, yes.
Very dead.
In pool of water.
Huh, so drowned.
We're not really sure, to be honest. It looked like it was down there for some reason, but we're not sure. We did find this moonstone. And I show them the moonstone.
Our friend here, he used power of moon to kill some water. The water attacked us. It was very, very odd.
That's more or less what happened, yes.
Yeah, well, I mean, we were attacked by dust, so...
Dust?
Yeah.
We've been attacked by the earth and the water.
I mean, as far as I know, dust is more like skin cells, but... Sure, yeah.
So not like dirt dust, but...
Like dust, like the stuff on the ground.
Either way, these elemental creatures are abominations, and we should get out of here immediately.
I mean, I would just head on down the hall.
Okay. You've sort of been into this hall before.
Yeah,
there are
a little bit.
Six enormous murals which are painted on the walls. Each one depicts something different as you walk past. There's one which is a barren wasteland dotted by dark pits. There's a huge, vast desert. There's one which is a bottomless pit with just lots and lots of bridge crisscrossing over it. There's a swamp in one of them. There's one which is an endless series of decrepit courtyards filled with weird demonic figures. And there's one which is a wasteland punctuated by hundreds of different volcanoes. Anybody who's looking or interested in them can give me a religion check to see if you can work out what they're supposedly of.
Can I also do history?
Yeah.
That don't help me at all.
Just you two? No one else gives a shit? You're just bumbling through?
To see how much I like them. Roll for art critic.
Yeah.
Roll for aesthetic.
You can roll a d20, a one being that you hate them. Yeah, you don't mind these. Both Petrello and Valris, looking over these things, are able to determine that each of the murals depicts a different layer of the abyss, which, as you can guess, is awful. As you're looking over them, though, let's see. Petrello, Gondash, because you are looking at them, you just don't care what they are, just whether you like them. And Valris, you'll see that they start to like quiver and move a little bit, like maybe they are watery, like they start to move like ripples on water. And a set of eyes appears in front of each of these paintings, and then a chittering little creature comes out, green and reptilian kind of looking. They have little wings and they have little sticks in their hands, and they come out muttering to themselves in a very strange language. What do you speak, you guys?
Not abyssal.
Yeah.
Not abyssal.
Giant.
Common, elvish, sylvan, celestial, and tiscant.
Giant.
Alright, so... in that case, you have no idea what they're saying. They just come chittering through, and they suddenly appear and step out through the thing. The ones, here they are, Give me nature checks, each of you, to see if you recognize what they might be. Maybe even a history check, if you want to do a history check, Valris, because you've done all that stuff.
Please.
Petrello knows what they are, and Petrello alone. Petrello, you recognize these from storybooks, from weird history books, and maybe even like children's storybooks, but the more like demonic ones that tell frightening stories of the abyss as quasits. And I'm going to need everyone to roll me initiative as four of these MFs come creeping through and they attack. Let me remove all these turns from this thing.
Did we have the possibility of doing a long rest, by the way?
Of course you did. You always do.
Yeah. Yeah.
You had
Shillelagh all the way.
Yeah, had all the time in the world. So yeah, these little things come creeping through. And they don't look friendly at all. That's fucking loud.
Does one of them call up Miranda?
Is one of them called Miranda? Why do you ask?
The name of my Quasit companion in her campaign.
Oh.
I've got a little one.
No then, because that would be awful. I wouldn't make you kill your own companion in another world.
I mean, I hate her. It's fine.
Actually, it's fine.
We all do.
Actually, it's fine. I love her. She's great.
You're the DM, though, you know.
So remember, to roll initiative, you need to click onto your token and then click initiative to be able to roll it. All right, I'm going to do this week so that people can actually see the turn order because they couldn't see it last week.
Wait, my thing isn't on the turn order. Like, my character.
Neither is mine.
Do you have to roll again?
Because you didn't do it. Right, hold on. Who do we not have?
I did.
Did you click on your thing?
Yes.
I don't believe
I did.
Well, I guess it was too early.
Petrello rolled a 10. Okay. So, the first thing... I don't know why this is so, like, loud. The first thing to react is the... Quasit, which is just behind Petrello. I'm going to roll a d2, well, d4, which I'm going to round up. So this thing comes chittering out and spies a roguish looking elven type woman. And I wonder if this has to be able to. Can you do this? No. Okay, this thing's going to just fly over here pretty quickly and bring its little... It's got like a little stick with a sharp end, very rudimentary, and it's going to strike at my dear sweet Valris there. I've just remembered that I've been rolling stuff in here. So, what is it to hit? 1d20 plus 5 to hit. What is your AC? Not that low, I'm sure. So it comes... And it probably hits like your cloak or something, completely confused as to which part of you is actually your body. And yeah, you are quite able to avoid it. Malkai, your turn.
I'm gonna attack this one with my battle axe.
All right, roll to hit. 14 is a hit. Nice. Yeah. Cool. You come swinging at this thing here and behead it. Its tiny little head with these huge bug-like eyes rolls off into the dusty room beyond as you behead this little guy with a little screech before it's cut short. Gondash, you see... this little guy here come running over to you and it just sticks its little sticky stick towards you, trying to stab at you with a 20.
Yeah, that hits me.
Yeah? All right.
Yeah.
So this is going to be a 1d4 plus 3. So it strikes you for 6, stabbing into one of your considerable half-orc legs. Give me a constitution saving throw, please. Nice. As you look down, this thing's the little stick, the barbs on this stick glisten with something. The one which is next to Petrello here turns to Petrello, and this one, give me a wisdom saving throw, please, Petrello, as this thing's eyes and mouth and chittering face seem to grow and expand in front of you, as it appears to be trying to cast some sort of weird magical magic on you, but you're like, mate, you don't scare me, I'm Petrello, and it lets out a little and it is not very scary at all. You're not frightened of it. Petrello, it is your turn.
By the way, how do I keep track of how many spells I've used and stuff? Because I didn't do that last time.
Good. Really good.
I can vaguely remember, I think. But
all right, so on your character sheet, where you've got spells, yeah? You see you've got above Cure Wounds there, you've got 4 and then a 0 next to it.
Okay, yeah.
The 4 is how many slots you have. The 0 is how many you've used.
So
I mean, does anyone have any idea how many he used last session?
I've used both of my level 2 ones, I know that for sure. Did
okay.
I do anything else? I didn't do any level 1s, did I?
Have you cured anyone?
I don't think so. I feel like the only person who did any healing was...
it was Marina, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, I don't remember seeing any of these either. So, yeah, you've probably got all 4 of them. We'll say you got all 4. Why not?
Either way, I'm going to do Shillelagh.
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 Have you heard the music of Shillelagh?
Yeah, whack him around the head.
Nice. That is a hit, yes. As you bring this magical staff down on him and squarely smack him in the head. It breaks his head open, but not like exploding. Just you cut a huge gash in the top of this thing's head and thick, dark purple oozing blood starts to run down his face. He closes one of his eyes, looking up at you. He's not happy at all. He's not happy, and he's kind of stumbling about, but he's still standing. That was your bonus to cast Shillelagh as well. So Valoris,
yep.
It is your turn.
I'm gonna shoot the one next to Gondash with my bow.
Alright, do it.
Is that sneak attack? Because he's within 5 feet of Gondash?
Yeah, if you hit.
Neat.
That is definitely a hit. Be very surprised if you don't kill it. Add the sneak attack damage.
2d6.
Nice. So this thing has a little tiny spear type thing in Gondash's leg and has an arrow straight through one eye. He lets go of it. The little spear thing, which is only about a foot in length, Gondash, is still in your leg, just for the record, because he lets go of it and falls down with an arrow through the eye. This one is dead. Anything else from you, Valoris?
No.
Well, no.
Actually, hold on. Do I have to disengage from the green one?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna do that as my bonus action.
Mm-hmm.
And then just move back.
Cool. Bitch. The little purplish-looking one comes running forward and attempts to stab another one of these little spears into Gondash's leg. I'm guessing that's a miss.
That is a miss, yeah.
Barely just misses your leg there as you move out of the way. I wonder if it can. No, it can't. Okay, Gondash, it's your turn.
Right, so... Again, I get out my Warhammer in one hand, and it just bursts into flame, and I smash the Quasar around the face with Burning Hands at level 1. Dex save has to be...
Dexterity is...
Has to be 12, not 20.
Nope. Takes the full 7 fire damage there.
Everything in a cone. Everything in a cone of 15 feet.
Okay, it's still just one. It's still just that one everything. Little guy.
also, can I roll for wild? Can I roll the d20 now? For the wild magic thing?
Yes, yeah. I'm straight up relying on you to remember that.
Fuck. Right, the amount of bell slots, guys.
Okay. Malkai.
Yeah, I'm just going to run up to that one and hit him again with my battle axe. Yes.
Okay.
If I can do. Oh my god. There it is.
That is a hit.
Nice.
For 7. Which one is this guy? Yeah, cool. So you just bring this battle axe into this thing's back, almost completely carves it in half, and it just falls down in almost 2 pieces at Petrello's legs. Anything else?
Nope.
Okay, it's Petrello's go.
Oh shit, I wasn't counting on the guy next to me being dead. I thought I'd be able to finish him. Yeah, I'm just going to do a hop, skip, and a jump over to this guy, I reckon, without getting any attacks of opportunity, hopefully. And, jumping over all these dead bodies and another shillelagh crack on the head.
All right, roll your shillelaghy. That is a miss as you, and this thing just ducks down, chittering as he does so. And Valrys?
Yeah. Hold on. I'm going to move over here so that I can have...
Excuse me. I will die.
I'm gonna move closer. That should work, right?
This should work.
I'm gonna shoot again.
Okay. That is a hit. Roll all that sweet damage there.
Okay, and the sneak attack.
Nice. So this arrow flies just past Gondash's ear, hears it whistle, and it strikes this little quasi in his heart, and it goes, and it falls backwards. And as soon as it hits the ground, each of these paintings starts to ripple, and you hear a sound come through it, a very strange sound. Everybody give me perception checks to see if you can hear exactly what the noise is that's coming through these paintings. Okay, everyone just hears some very strange, odd kind of noises that don't seem to mean anything. However, Malkai, you hear a specific and strange alien phrase which says, "Thunder! Thunder! Thundercats! Ha!" And then this little quasit here raises back up. And then he starts to transform and change, and he grows... very, very large, and his eyes, although huge and black already, start to like dribble and ooze like an inkish purple. The arrow which was in his heart, you see all these odd purplish lines spread out from it, and he lets out a terrifying roar. As I need everybody to make a wisdom saving throw, please.
Damn, Daniel.
I was hoping that was my one.
Damn, Daniel. You have to beat a 10.
Yes.
So let's see. Gondash is so confusing because you've got Leith.
It changes every time.
Gondash and Valris, you are frightened for 1 minute of this creature. Do you know what frightened means? I'm going to reiterate it for you anyway. A frightened creature has disadvantage on ability checks and attack rolls whilst the source of its fear is within a line of sight and you can't willingly move closer to the creature. The other two of you steel yourselves and you're not quite as frightened, though Gondash, possibly for one of the first times in his life, is suddenly hugely frightened of this strange abyssal demon creature which has come back to life and grown to a larger size in front of him. Valris is completely freaked out right now. And the little Quozzit has this tiny little stick in his hand, throws it down, psh, snaps, and he starts getting ready like this in front of each of you. Gondash, it's your turn.
So I have to flee, right?
No, you just can't move closer.
I just can't move closer? Okay. Well, it's not too much I can do, so let's just firebolt it, I guess.
Alright.
Oh gosh.
Just firebolt it.
Firebolt with disadvantage.
With disadvantage.
That is an 8. You launch a firebolt into the room beyond. You hear a smash of glass. Psh! You can make a wisdom saving throw to try and beat a 10 to snap out of this fear.
I want to do that. I don't think I can do that.
You are still completely petrified of this thing. Give me a constitution saving throw to see if you wet yourself.
I'm pretty...
You're right. You hold your bladder. Maokai.
I'm going to stay away a bit and use Sacred Flame.
Sacred Flame, 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 Flame. Dex save for my little thing here. Let's see. 18, so
oh,
it
shit.
Takes half of that. Is that correct? Or no? Or none?
Half. Wait, yeah, half damage.
Half damage? All right, mm-hmm. So the Sacred Flame launches forward, but this thing just hits his arms. Doesn't seem to hit him in anywhere too vulnerable on his body. And he's all right. He's all right, I guess. He's all right. He takes half of that. Rounded down. I've always rounded up, and it's apparently rounding down. So, lol. I think you round up on death saving throws, and that's it.
And we're the ones you worked that out with.
No, I think I worked it out on Wolf's channel the other night. I just didn't know. Alright, so yeah, you do a little bit of damage to him. It scorches his arms. He lets a little bit of a cry out, but it's not a huge amount. He carries on. Petrello, it's your turn.
I'm within its threat range, right?
Yes.
I really regret going up there now. Backing it in the chest with my shillelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelelel
Shillelagh. That is a hit. 10 bludgeoning damage from this devastating shillelagh weapon. And yeah, you just bring this thing in and you crack this thing. You feel underneath, because he's kind of got his arms up like this, you feel this thing smash into its side and a couple of bones crunch. And it goes and looks down at you, Petrello, as you...
I feel like some of the leaves and twigs kind of come off my shillelagh a bit.
Probably, yeah. A few leaves and twigs dance down to the ground. The halfling should have advantage against fear checks. That is correct, Ozzy. But it's up to the halfling to remember that. And if she doesn't, what's done is done. But she made the fear check for now, but remember that. Remember, almost all of your ones can be re-rolled and you have advantage on thingy checks. Also, depending on what type of halfling you are, I think you also get some sort of poison advantage. Anyway, Valris, you are frightened of this thing.
Yeah.
Valris drops a beat. Yeah. Anyway.
Sure. I'm still going to try to shoot it because I can't really do anything else. I don't think that hits, right?
No, because you have disadvantage, so you quivering little hands send this thing off, flies into the room beyond. Again, you hear another smash as something glass, made of glass, breaks, and you miss. You can make a whiz saving throw, though, to try and snap out of this fear.
I would like to do that, yes.
Yes, so like as soon as you hear that bottle smash, for some reason, you steel yourself, you look around you, this thing is slightly less frightening to you. You steel yourself and you're like, nah, do you know what? Fuck it. The giant quasit thing reaches up and swings down a huge mighty claw at Petrello. Petrello? What is
11
your AC?
Damage. What?
No, what's your AC?
Oh, where do I say? Oh, 13.
13, that is a miss. And as this thing swipes just past your face, you dodge out of the way. But the second one comes in, and that one will be a strike, I'm afraid, my dear sweet little boy. And it's going to deal 6 slash damage to your chest as its left claw scrapes across the front of you. Give me a con save as well, please, sir.
Shit.
You're going to take an extra 8 poison damage.
Awesome.
As this, so there's this horrible purplish ooze which you've seen coming out of its eyes, coming out of the dead ones, and spreading across this thing's chest where one of Valorous's arrows is sat. And the same kind of ooze is just around the edges of your wound, across the front of your chest there, and you are poisoned, so you actually are poisoned as well as taking the poison damage, which pretty much I think just gives you disadvantage on everything. For
but doesn't he have advantage on saves against poison? Isn't he a dwarf?
He's a hill dwarf.
Oh.
So I don't know.
Do they not get that?
I don't know. Do you, Zod?
I don't know.
Not all dwarfs.
Black dwarves matter.
It might be all. It might be all dwarves. I don't know. It's entirely up to Zod to find out right now.
Oh my god!
I have the page open. Hold on.
How do you spell dwarves?
L F.
You do.
Okay.
I do.
Yeah.
All right. You need to remember that from now on.
Yes, sir.
Luckily, Nora is here, and Nora knows. Her shit. Okay, so you don't take this
the 8 damage, poison. Right?
You do see this like purplish ooze across the edges of this wound, but it doesn't seem to affect your strong dwarven body. And
so blood. I can take back the 8 damage, or
you can take back the 8. The 6 is still dealt. Gondash.
Right. Well, I'm just gonna throw another fireball, I guess. I don't even have any rage uses left. I have nothing but fireball.
Give me a whiz save. Nice, yeah. So you're less scared now of this thing. It doesn't look like it's like really doing too great, to be honest. It looks like one side of it has been completely crushed in. Like 3 or 4 ribs have been shattered by a shillehi-lehi. And you're slightly less afraid of it for some reason. Maybe it's seeing Petrello take some damage there after Petrello just helped you out quite greatly against this thing, this water weird that was strangling you and dragging you to this horrible putrid war. Malkai, your turn.
I'm going to move up to it and attack with my battle axe.
Very nicely done, because you swing and you miss. Slightly low. Go on.
And I'm going to use my War Priest thing to attack again as my bonus action.
The War Priest strikes again. Striking true, the War Priest buries an axe into the quasit, dealing the exact amount of damage that you need to do to kill it. How do you want to kill him?
Just chop off his head, like jump up on him, kind of.
this tiny little halfling jumps up and you chop off his considerable head.
Go on an epic journey up his body to find his head.
Throw its head into a volcano. So you chop its head off, and as soon as you do so, you see each of these murals again shiver and quiver. But what happens is that each of the bodies disappears as if they were never there to begin with. And you've successfully defeated the Quozzits in the Hall of Murals. Congratulations, team. Congratulations.
Yay.
You all look a bit battered up now. A little bit battered. A little bit bruised.
Guys, do we maybe wanna, call it a day?
I don't know about you guys, but I am pooped. I would love a really long rest right now.
I would also be in favor of a rest, actually.
Yeah.
Resilience is it's not too good right now.
I mean, don't you want to check out what is in the next room?
If you can restore some of our vitality, as a.
How are you looking spell wise?
I can maybe do a little summon. If you're not.
Everyone's magical powers.
Quite beneficial.
If you want to move on.
You still have spell slots, everyone.
No.
I have a warhammer.
Okay.
I have a battle axe. I don't need spells.
I need to regain some spells desperately.
Also, while we're talking, I'm gonna go and see if I can pick up any arrows in the hall.
All right, one of them disappeared inside of the quozzit there.
Yeah.
How many did you fire apart from that?
Three, I believe.
Roll me a 1d3 and take back whichever you roll. Oh, actually, no, one of them went into the other room, so you'll have to go into the other room. Yeah.
Nah.
Gonna move it forward.
I'm good. I have 13 arrows left.
Okay.
Fine. let's just go back into the dead guy room and maybe take a little.
Perhaps we should not sleep in the room with the smell.
That should we sleep in the room with the eyes, or in the room with the creepy pictures, or?
It's kind of lose-lose, isn't it?
The room that we were at with the pool of water. It seemed safe, apart from the...
I feel like if we go back there could be more monsters, though. Why don't we just rest here? Is the smell that bad here? We've kind of moved on a bit from it.
So we have to take watches anyway. I only need, 4 hours of sleep, so I can take 2 watches, and then the other guys can see what you want to do.
How long's a long rest?
Long rest is 8 hours, I think. No, wait, it'd be...
8 hours of sleep and I think 10 of rest overall.
There we go, that's the rule.
Thank you.
Oh, I do it.
Nora's a way better DM than I am. Nora, you should run the next one.
Literally. Let's sleep here.
We're playing pretty much all standard rules. For these, so yeah, ignore all of my homebrew shit apart from scrolls. Scrolls is the only homebrew thing that I'll probably force into this. So you're gonna sleep in the dust room, did you say?
If there are monsters or enemies in the next room, then what is stopping them from coming here, 20 feet away from them?
They do not know we're here yet.
We've been making quite
I kind of fired an arrow in there, so probably
if we retreat slightly to preferably somewhere where there wasn't the smell of death, perhaps we would have a safer night's rest.
So perhaps it'll be a bit safer.
Yeah, okay, let's go to the water room want to do that. Yeah. That way we only have one exit to watch.
Yeah, let's do it.
Alright, so you guys head backwards, back past the dust room, back through the room. All the eyes in this room turn and watch you move through, All the ones that you
Didn't we explode them?
Back.
Yeah.
They all come back after I think it was like 7 seconds. And you make it back down into this room. There's a fairly nasty pong from the rotting, soaking wet, bloated halfling corpse that you dragged out of the pool of water and left. Other than that, this room appears to be fairly empty, just very, very little going on. There's a pool of water which doesn't smell too great, but also isn't quite as offensive to the nasal passages as the rotting human. And you guys can begin your rest. So how did you say you're barricading this doorway, or are you just watching that door? Someone's going to sit in that door on the watch.
I want to try to barricade it a little bit. If I can lift anything in front of it.
There's some scraps of wood in this room. In the room that you just came through with the eyes, there are like tables and chairs, and there's like divans, which are like futon type things that you could turn, maybe like little beds.
Yeah, then I'm going to get Gondash to help me and like get a table in. Or actually, I'm going to tell Gondash to bring a table because I'm weak as fuck.
I will assist.
All right, so you bring a table and you sort of bring that up as a small palisade wall. Yeah. And all right, so in which order will you be taking your rest? You say you're going for a long rest. Are you actually going to like catch up in this place for as long as you can?
Yeah.
I mean, they're not going to be any more dead.
Yeah.
No worries.
Yeah. Sure.
Like 20 years that they've been missing. It's fine. Can I take the first watch? Because I want to like set up a campfire and with my bonfire spell.
Yeah, sure. I'm going to take the second and third. Kind of, because I only need.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
No, I need 4 consecutive hours of trance, I think.
Yeah.
Probably, I'm gonna take the last 2 watches. Yeah.
Okay.
And then I'm just gonna sit cross-legged.
All right.
And do the little weird elf thing.
So it's Gondash. For 4 hours, and then Valris, you're just taking the rest of the rests?
Yeah, I'm gonna take the last 4 hours. So I don't know if I think we technically only can take 2 hours unless we're elves, because we need 6 hours of sleep for a long rest, so someone has to take the second watch.
I mean, I don't think it has to be like a consecutive 6 hours. I think you just need to, because as long as you're not doing anything strenuous, it still counts as downtime kind of thing, like rest time. So
I just don't know if like how elf stuff works, but regardless, someone has to take the last 2 hours, because otherwise Gondash won't get his 6 hours of sleep.
Gondash wants his 6 hours of sleep.
Yeah.
All right. So, Gondash for 4 hours, Valris for 4 hours. No, Valris for 8 hours.
Gondash for 2 hours.
2 hours of.
And
I'm lost. I don't understand how long this rest is and what's going on.
We need 8 hours of sleep, and then it's like I think the DM's guide says like 2 hours for setting up camp and then, you know, packing everything and going back.
So you need 10 hours. Like, let's just say 10 hours is what you need.
Like we need watches for 8 hours. When we're packing up and stuff,
Nora's got 4 of that 8, so that's 6 of the 8, and we need
someone needs to take the third portion of the rest. Which is which one of you will it be? Okay, it's Malcolm. Okay.
Do I get
way too long
afterwards?
Huh?
Or no?
Yeah, no. You. So the thing is, you don't have to sleep. This isn't that you need to be completely asleep. You just need to be fucking sat still. You can read for your time and sleep for some of it and read for the rest, or just very lightly pace up and down kind of thing. If you're fighting a dragon, then your rest will be broken.
I now understand the long rest mechanic, finally.
Yeah, you just need to just chill the fuck out for a bit. All right, so you make a little barricade for a couple of hours and then settle down for a little sleepy. Gondash sits presumably by the doorway just behind their little wall that they made, and roll me a d20.
Okay. Can we go on break after this, Rust? Because I need the toilet.
Okay. Straight away, Gondash, you start to hear very strange noises from down this hallway. Give me a perception check.
Of course I do.
Yeah, there's something fucking weird heading down this hallway. It's light, it's bright, and it's moving down this hall. It's possibly a torch, and it's starting to move down the hallway towards you. What do you want to do just before we go on to a break?
Instantly put out my bonfire and kind of get under my winter blanket.
Okay. You hide like a child.
I camouflage myself in the darkness so you can't.
Give me
it's
a stealth.
Hard to see me.
In real life.
In real life. I want to do a stealth under my blanket.
All right.
But so I can still see what's happening. It's just harder to see me.
That's fair. Let's see. All right. So since you're under the thing, you can't see the thing anymore, and we'll go on to a break. We'll be back in a couple of minutes, and we'll see what the fuck happens to them all while their watch hides like a child under a blanket behind a table turned upright. We'll see you in a couple of minutes. Go and go for your own wee-wees, or shoot up some heroin if you really want to enjoy the last part of this thing. It does. We're all on heroin right now. I'm not even going to deny that. Okay, because I want that seed to be sown, and then when the rumors begin and they're like, can you believe these rumors were spread, I'll be like, I spread them.
I'm on so much heroin right now.
I spread them. See you in a couple of minutes. You and he were buddies, weren't you? Welcome back to...
You and he were buddies, weren't you?
Welcome back to Wizard in a Bottle. Ahead of the party, down this hallway, a terrible, horrible, horrendous creature, possibly one of the worst things you could ever imagine actually floating towards you in this situation that they are particularly in right now, is floating around in the room ahead of them, the room with all the eyes and things like that. As it sort of rounds the corner in the furthest part of the room ahead of you, Gondash sees it, puts out his fire, or like ends his magical cantrip bonfire, and ducks under his winter blanket and goes as still and as quiet as he can, and then what do you do, Gondash?
I sit and wait it out.
Alright. After about 15 minutes, nothing has happened to you.
Does it seem like it's... Can I do a perception check to see if like I can hear it getting closer?
Yeah.
Or see it getting closer? It's gone.
You can't tell. All you can hear is the very light breathing of each of your compatriots.
Okay. I get out from my blanket.
Hmm.
In the hopes that it's just gone away.
Yeah, looking into the other room, it's pitch black again. As far as your dark vision can see, okay. There's nothing in there.
I just go back to thinking about things.
Alright, nice, yeah. Full disclosure, it rolled a 1 on its perception check to find you, and that's basically the reason that it didn't see you, so well done. It would have been horrible as well to fight it, trust me.
Yes, well done. Well done.
Trust me, it would have been an awful, awful thing to have to fight in your current state. Then you probably would have done it, but it would have been like... Okay.
I have 3 health and no spell slots.
After two hours, you... Oh, wait, you're doing 4 hours. Yeah, you're doing...
I'm doing 2 hours.
You're doing 2?
I'm doing 4.
Nora's doing 4.
But when does Valris get her 4 hours of rest? Or have you been asleep while he's been setting up the camp?
I've been asleep. Wait.
Because you need 4 hours, right?
Yeah, I can do 2 while he's watching and then 2 while Malke is watching, right?
Okay, so you're going to do it that way. All right. So, yeah. All right. So after 2 hours, Gondash, feel free to wake up Valris.
Kind of shake it. Take her a little bit, and then I just go sleep on the mold.
There was a light. I think it's gone now, but just be careful.
Okay. Thanks.
We should be safe. It seems to have left, but just be wary of that. And then I go to sleep.
Okay. I'm gonna take up watch. I'm gonna hide, because I'm good at that.
Okay. Give me a stealth check.
Stealth. Yeah, I'm good at that.
Yep. All right, so give me a d20 while you're sitting around. Okay. After a few hours, you're sitting there quietly, chilling in a very dark little part of this hallway, hidden very well, masked, as only elves can do very well, in this barest of shadows behind a table. You're doing 4 hours of watch?
Yeah.
Then your time passes. You don't see anything. There's no weird little creature. Nothing comes out at you. There's no floating flame thing. And you can wake up Malkai. Malkai, Gondash, and Petrella. You can roll hit die if you want to roll hit die. You have 3.
Yes.
Wait, what?
Hit die on a long rest?
You've, You've completed a short rest.
So does anyone know what mine are?
Well, on your sheet, you have a little button that says hit die, actually, so you can just click that, and it'll do it for
where
you.
Where would that be?
Dead in the middle of the main page, yeah, there's just click on the word hit dice, and it'll do it all for you. You can roll it 3 times in total, so you have 3 hit dice, and you can get back HP equal to whatever it rolls.
Yeah.
Alright, cool. Yeah, so do you wake up Maokai now, Valoris?
Yeah, and I'm gonna tell her what Gondash saw. Let you hide and stay quiet.
Just gonna hide behind the table.
Alright. And we enter the last 2 hours, I think. Or last 4 hours? Is it 2 or 4?
I think it's
4.
It must be
2 of sleep and then...
Wait, no, it's 2.
Where we set up, or like head out, gather stuff.
Okay. Yeah, so you enter a trance state and Maokai needs to roll me a d20, please.
Okay.
Anything you get back on a short rest, you've got back for your class. And anything that you get back on a long rest, you have not yet. Give me a perception check.
Yes.
Cool. You're sitting behind this table, keeping as quiet as you can, and you hear a very strange slithering noise coming from above you. As you look up, clinging to the ceiling, there is something which looks like a giant great lava, like a fly larvae thing. But it has one huge, horrible red eye. It looks like a cat's eye, and it's kind of looking down on you. And if you look a little closer, because your perception was pretty high, it's clinging onto the roof by tiny little legs, and it drops onto you from the ceiling. Let's see what happens to you here, since you are technically taken by surprise. What is your AC?
18.
So as you look up, this thing drops down towards you. It's got a horrible little pincery face. You just dive out of the way. Do you have a shield?
Yes.
Rolling out of the way, this thing, boom, lands on the shield. You shrug it off and it lands directly in front of you. I need you to roll. Everyone roll initiative, though. Most of you are asleep. Give me con saves, each of you, to see if you wake up.
Well, can I not, shout or something?
I mean, it makes a big loud thud on the ground and hits a shield, so it does one level of landing thing.
Didn't get full long rest right, so I need to roll for hit die. So I've got short rest.
You can not fight this thing, technically. You guys could just roll over and go to sleep, or just go and sit quietly in a corner and just let Maokai 1v1 this thing if you want to risk that. I don't see why you would. If you can justify it to me, then...
I'm going to roll hit dice.
I need like a little token for it. Hold on.
Okay.
Sorcerer hit dice or barbarian hit dice?
Well, you have 2 sorcerers and 1 barbarian. When you click hit dice, it should give you the option, actually.
Right. So how many do I have in total? 3.
You have 1 barbarian and 2 sorcerer. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So
you have 1. I think it's 1d. 12? 1d12 and 2d6.
That's the 12.
Plus con.
And then...
Maokai, I'm going to say that you're like here because you were sat behind the table, right? Which I have assumed it was like here.
Did I have a short rest or...
No.
I just had a short one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure what I get back for that.
Let's have a real quick look. So, this is why you seriously need to read your classes. Just read your thing. Just know whatever the fuck your class does.
My apologies.
That's all right. I it's just that I can never remember everyone's individual.
I'm really sorry, Brad. All right.
Individual class things. I usually remember if I've played it, but I've never fucking played a druid, so I don't know. So on a mainly, I guess you need to worry about your spells. So short rest. So you still have your wild shapes anyway. And I think your spells come back after a long rest. Yeah, so you won't have any new spell slots back.
Okay.
You'll have still the ones that you didn't use, and you still have your wild shape thing.
But then if I have another, 2 hours, is it? Then I will.
Yeah. Unless you do anything vigorous, like help Malkai fight this thing. If you're lucky...
Oh, no, but I mean in the future, if we have another couple fights or whatever, and then I have 2 hours, then I'll get everything back.
Yeah, you need to take a long rest for this thing. Let me just roll this thing's initiative, and we'll just jump in, and we'll deal with it in a second. This thing rolls 19. Who hasn't rolled yet? Okay, Gondash Valris.
I didn't do initiative. Should I do that?
Yeah. You need to do it even if you don't do anything. Where were your con saves? Each of you wakes up hearing this strange thud noise. There's a very obvious in this very dark, quiet corridor noise of somebody rolling to one side with a clash of probably chainmail. Or at least metal and shield, as Malkai does a roll to one side, and there's a boom, and then there's a thing which is writing itself up, which just looks like a huge slimy larvae worm type thing with little sharp bits and a couple of tiny little legs on it. Valris, though you are on the ground, you're prone right now. What do you do?
I'm gonna get up. That's half my movement, right? I'm going to move over here. And then I'm just gonna shoot an arrow at it.
Fire an arrow. Wow. Fire away.
Arrow. Pew! Yay! Oh, shit. Yay.
Yep.
It's dead.
Oh yeah.
We've done it.
That also doubles the sneak attack, right? Because it's double dice.
I don't know, does it? I think probably.
I'm pretty sure yeah.
I don't see why it wouldn't.
Always doubles dice. Yeah.
Alright, so 11, then plus 4d6 is
4d6. Okay, now.
Insane.
Why is that again? I missed why that is.
Because she has a sneak attack if she if there's something near the thing. If one of her allies is near the thing being attacked, then it's distracted from her, so it can't see. And also, if it just can't see her, she's hidden or something like that, then it's also a sneak attack. So she's using the opportunity to hit somewhere very vital on it. In this case, she just, as soon as this thing hits this shield and Malkai rolls to one side, brings a sword up, this arrow just whoosh, flies towards this thing, pierces straight into its eye, and it rolls over dead. just rolls backwards. It's you barely have a chance to react as you look up and see this thing. There's this loud crash, and then an arrow, you just... A couple of steps heard from behind you, and then a thump as an arrow just strikes this thing straight through the eye, straight through the brain, kills it in one, and she just sits back down and enters a trance state. The rest of you can carry on too, actually. You'll have to do another 4 hours, though. This is the thing. You'll still have to do another 4 hours of... trance state kind of thing as as you sort of used some level of vigorous movement. But the rest of you, after a couple of hours, Malkai, I presume you just carry on the rest, maybe readjust the table. And I mean, if you look over this thing, give me a nature check for your last 2 hours. I presume you're going to take a quick look at whatever this horrible little creature is.
Am I good?
You're not 100% sure, but it's probably a piercer, which is just a horrible little subterranean monstrous thing that creeps around weird underground passages. And there's just nothing. There's nothing on it. You can't eat it. You can eat it, but most people don't eat it. I don't know if you want to deal with it in any way, but your 2 hours pass, and everybody gets the effects of a long rest, including Valris. After 4 hours, you come back out of this trance state, and you all feel perfectly revitalized. You get half of your hit die back that you've used.
I really am a fan of using all of my hit die, then. For no reason. Is that rounding up or rounding down?
Round down, I guess.
Yeah. We get one.
Wait, you only get half of what you rolled for your hit die back?
Half of your max.
No, you get the actual hit die you have three of, you get half of them back.
So for one, it's zero.
Can I pick which hit die I get back? Because I prefer my barbarian hit die, to be honest.
That's really weird. Yeah, sure. Let's see what it is that you actually need to remember. Hit die you round up. Hit die after a long rest you round up. Druid and wizard spell slots you round up, but it says you get them all back, so I don't understand what that means. And I think, yeah, okay. So yeah, you round up.
That might be on a short rest, because wizard you get half of your level as spell slots back on a short rest.
Okay. I don't know why it says druid then, because I just read druid. It doesn't matter. Okay, so you get... I mean, you've got all your spell slots back, you've got HP back, and half of your hit die rounded up back. Each of you wakes up, you feel okay, and you can proceed if you would like to, after moving a table and possibly a horrible piercer creature out of the way.
Can I get my arrow back? Do I have to roll 1d1?
You have to roll a d2. If you roll a 1, it's broken.
Okay.
No, you get it back. It's fine. It's the greatest arrow you've ever fired. Of course it's fine. It's got some piercer slime eye goop on it, but...
No, I don't care.
All right. What do you guys want to do?
Did we actually loot those, what are they called? Quasits?
They disappeared.
Okay.
So I think they are naked and only carry sticks, so... Yeah.
Demons, mate.
Demons.
They're demon blood, aren't they?
Typical demons.
Demon blood.
Alright, where do you go?
Back up, I think. Back to the hallway.
Back up, back to the hallway.
Yeah, I want to keep an eye out to see if I see anything weird, sketchy, you know.
Okay. Give me a perception check.
Snooping around.
As you head through each of these rooms. Yeah, everything seems okay. You don't spot the thing which was flying around that Gondash saw. And you head back to this room with all of the weird murals on it. At the end of this room, where you started moving through the hallway, you can sort of see into another room at the end here. that, well, you just wandered straight in. As you wander in, you look around. It looks kind of like if you were to combine a library with a laboratory. There's all sorts of shelves that run around all of the walls, multiple layers of shelves. It's super untidy. There's a few like benches and things, like work benches, just filled with all sorts of like typical alchemical equipment. In the middle of the room, there are bookshelves which contain all sorts of various different literature. Along each of these benches, mostly it's like alchemists' things, bowls, funnels, flasks, mortar and pestles, little furnaces and alembics, and then just hundreds upon hundreds of little containers, big containers, and they all contained at one point various different ingredients, most of which have perished. The air smells very strongly of sulfur and dust as you approach.
Can I check for traps?
Sure. First. Give me a perception check.
Investigation?
Perception.
Oh. Really?
Yeah, trust me, you're going to want to do a perception check. Doesn't matter, though. As you head up, there's no traps.
Okay. I'm straight up going to go for the first bookshelf and start looking for any kind of history book that I might be interested in.
I also look for books.
All right. Everyone give me another perception check.
There are more books than Gondash has ever seen.
I'm not looking at anything else anymore. I'm just looking at the books.
Cool. Petrello's, I don't know what you were looking for, if anything, but nothing really stands out to you. You're just looking at all these various things, empty flasks, picking them up, putting them down. It's not a big, it's not super interesting to you. Gondash, where are you? You're just stood in the middle of the room. You're looking about. Where are you stood closest to? Like this one, we'll say you're kind of looking over here at like this stuff here. On this bench, you'll find two potions of healing, which are still good, stoppered, and you can take them if you'd like. Malkai, looking on here, you see a strange flask. It's got a very odd translucent blue liquid in it. Suspended within this thing, within this little flask here, is a very small, like 3-inch tall human. And then lastly, Valoris, you were looking for books. Let's see what book you find.
Did you say there were potions of healing?
You have two potions of healing, yeah. Yeah, looking over these shelves, you're looking for a history book. Sure, yeah, you find a very big book of history, which is the lore of Baldur's Gate. So you now have a lore book.
I don't even care about anything else anymore. I just start reading it and like get out my little notebook and start taking notes.
All right.
Strategy guide.
What?
Baldur's Gate strategy guide.
Yeah, a Baldur's Gate strategy guide. It is at this moment, as Malkai looks down and just spots that there's a little human person inside this very strange flask of liquid, Valoris opens a book, just very interested in this like fairly good looking rare book based on like a huge in-depth history of the town Baldur's Gate, that a flask lifts up from the table near where Gondash is and flies at him. Give me a dexterity check. Thirteen. The flask flies straight towards Gondash's face and strikes Gondash in the face. This is a green flask. and it does. Oh my god, please don't do this to me. There we go. 8 poison damage. Give me a con save.
Please don't.
You are now poisoned for 10 rounds.
Being healthy really doesn't last very long.
Anyone near you? No, you're all right. So, now roll me initiative, please.
As I hear the glass shatter, I yell at Gondash, can you just be a bit quiet, please? I'm trying to read here.
Did your magic book do this?
Shut up! It's working.
I am in pain. I
don't care.
It hurts. I did not do this. You did this to me with your book.
Who needs to roll an initiative here? Petrello, of course.
I was just entertained by this conversation. I always don't fucking click on myself first. I'm sorry.
That's okay. So I'm just putting a like little bottle here on the screen purely so that I have. It's not a thing, okay? It's purely so that I can add a fucking token to the thing for the flask's turn. I did too. Okay. Wait, Petrello, did you roll?
Yeah, but I didn't click on myself, so.
I hate you. All right. Petrello, what do you want to do? They're arguing between themselves.
I don't have a fucking clue.
Where is he?
Up here. What's going on? They're just having an argument.
They're having an argument. Someone smashed a glass and Gondash is like clawing at his face because he's completely poisoned by this horrible poisonous gas. And no one gives a shit.
I don't know. Some kind of check would be good, right? Some kind of arcana check to see what the fuck's going on.
I don't know. You tell me. What do you want to do?
Guys, what, metagame, please.
What do you want to check
honestly,
for?
I'm confused about why we rolled initiative when a fucking flask flew up my face.
Yeah.
And we can't attack the flask.
Right now. The flask is gone.
Flask has exploded over Gondash's face and his poison is fucked up right now.
I'm full of glass.
He's got glass in his eyes, he's blind forever, and he's got poison gas. In his
can, I have a, can I have like a scar across one eye now? Pure
roll me a
eye.
D20. If you roll above a 10, you can have a cool scar at the end of this if you survive.
Oh yes. No.
No.
Fuck. Okay. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm just gonna read this spell.
What are you doing?
Fuck it. Yeah, I'm not entirely sure what this spell does, but I'm gonna do my fairy fire spell to try and reveal creatures around. I guess.
Okay.
If that does that.
Yeah, so fairy fire, you have to choose things to be outlined, I think.
It's within a 20-foot cube.
Area, yeah. I think everyone has to make a dex save, and if you don't succeed on it, you're, like, outlined and people have advantage on attacks on you.
You can pick whatever you want to be outlined. In this room.
Oh, there's nothing. I don't know. All right, I'm not going to do that. Fuck it. I'm going to just do a general arcana check. I don't know.
Okay, give me an arcana check.
0. Awesome.
19. Using like your powers of magic and arcana, something is amiss in this room. Though you can't work out exactly what it is. There is some sort of strange magic feel to something. Like something is charging the room with like magic and throwing things at people. You can't see what it is because this is like a sense check to see what it is, but there is definitely a presence in this room launching shit at people, basically. You gather
that.
Can
I tell the others if there's a bonus action that
no
there's some
because you took so long? No. Gondash, it's your turn.
Right. Can I try and knock the book out of Valorous's hands?
Yes. Please? Roll to hit.
Roll to hit.
This is kind of a disarm, isn't it? So,
yeah.
I guess
yeah.
Actually, you need to do a contested strength or acrobatics check.
I'm gonna do acrobatics and
try to. Do it.
I'm gonna try to jump out of the way. Acrobatics.
Yeah, you good luck. Yeah, backflip, triple backflip, tuck Pike out of the way. Perfect landing, and yeah, Gondash rolls a 6. You have
a druid. The book is evil.
You have all.
It's not the book.
You say book gives magic. You read book. I hurt by magic.
I don't even have book any magic.
The book has the magic. You said.
No, it's a history book. It has words. Books don't have. I didn't do any magic before. I completely bullshitted with you.
You lied to Gondash?
Yeah.
So books, they have no magic?
No. I mean, some do, but this doesn't.
Then why? Then what is use of book?
Like, why would knowledge?
Who needs knowledge when you have magic?
All right, it's Varus' turn. This full conversation.
Having a 6-second conversation here.
Is that your turn? You're having that conversation for your turn?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, because you don't know what's going on.
He doesn't pay attention.
Malachi. Petrello looks like he's, like, confused and trying to work out what's going on. Then he looks slightly panicked. He's about to open his mouth and tell you all what he thinks is happening. Behind you, these two are arguing. Gondash is just covered in horrible green poison and he looks all messed up, like possibly he's got disadvantage on all of his checks for 10 rounds.
Possibly.
And what do you want to do?
Could I? So, how about what if I create water above the place the flask came from, and like when it comes down we see like the thing that
where did the flask come from?
This general area.
How,
I guess.
How did you know that?
I don't know.
Unfortunately, so you have no idea where that flask come from because you were looking at another flask on the table in front of you that had like a little person in it. I'll put that on there for you just so that you feel, because I just happen to have these now where I looked for one. That is what you were looking at.
I'm gonna just pocket that and just.
You're gonna pocket it.
Yeah.
A
tiny person.
Yeah. Okay.
Pocket the tiny person in my pocket.
Yeah. So you use your action to grab at the flask. It's like, again, it's like very blue looking liquid, and suspended in it is a little person, and she's now in your pack. Then let's have a look. She, shall we? Oh, from the table in front of you, as you pick this thing up and put it in the pocket, give me a dexterity check.
Oh God, I can't read, people.
Another flask launches itself at you and you just duck out of the way as it flies up in the air and smashes on the ceiling above you. There's like a small explosion as flame licks out and dissipates above you. Actually, no, yeah, it just kind of burns out for a bit. Petrello.
I guess I just immediately warn everyone that
something
I know
is,
that
something is flinging flasks at everyone, full of
yeah.
Shit.
It's an external force, and it's not Valorous's books. Holy shit!
To be fair, technically, you have no idea whether it's Valorous's book which is doing it. There's just something doing it. It could technically be a book. Saying, you don't know what it is that's doing it. The book could be sentient.
We don't know.
Yeah, at this point, it could be anything.
I just want them to stop arguing. And
all right, yeah, something's attacking us, for fuck's sake, you shout.
Yeah.
all right. Yeah, I mean, you can still do an action if you want to try and do something else.
There's no action to do. I've been looking through my spells. Like, I could do that fairy fire thing, but I don't know what I would be highlighting. Okay. Does anyone need a wound, like a wound curing?
I mean, I'm gonna...
Can I do speak with animals?
I'm like... poisoned as shit right now, so I'd take anything.
Do you have anything that removes poison?
No.
Why can't you be a paladin?
Why can't I be a paladin?
I think clerics have some remove poison-y type spells.
He's not a cleric, he's a druid.
He's a druid! That's correct. Alright. Never mind. Gondash, it's your turn.
I suddenly transform into a cleric.
No. Gondash, go. What do you want to do? Petrello's shouting that some fucking thing is attacking everyone.
An external force.
Yes.
Perception check.
Give me a perception check.
Yay.
Yeah, looking around, you're like, I have no idea what's attacking us. Something's attacking us, but I don't know what it is. No idea. Just a room full of fucking science equipment, alchemical.
Was that an action or a bonus action? It was an action, right? To look around.
Yeah, because you're spending the time specifically like investigating the room. So yeah, I'm going to say it's an action.
I just kind of like pull glass out of my face then.
All right. Valris. Trello's screaming at everyone and Gondash starts like frantically looking around, but he looks like he has no idea what he's looking for.
Okay, so I'm also going to look around.
Okay.
I can't see stuff I can't see.
What do you do with the book in your hands at the moment? A very big book.
I put it in my backpack. If I can. Otherwise, I'm just going to put it under my arm. I'm not letting go of this book. For now.
Okay, so, yeah, looking about, you're like... desperately trying to find what it is that could be throwing things at everyone. There are multiple flasks in this room which look like they are things that you can use. There are currently 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different flasks in this room that have stuff in them. There are three which have like a weird greenish oozy stuff in there. There are two which look like they have a weird orange lava looking liquid in them, and there are three which have particularly bright looking blue liquid in them. Other than that, they seem to be the things in this room which are the most standout things. Everything else is just normal shit.
Okay, can I get to the lava looking ones?
Yes, there are a couple of lavery. They're on this desk here.
Okay.
There were three. One of them launched up at the ceiling and exploded. There are two left.
With my fast hand, still the book under my arm.
Hmm.
Can I grab both? Can I only grab one?
What are you doing with them?
I wanna throw them into the hallway where the new worlds are, just so that whoever is doing stuff can't use them against us.
Okay, you can throw one.
Okay, I'm gonna throw one like there.
Cool. Yeah, it throws. It goes off like a little fire incendiary grenade. Smashes. There's a bunch of fire that spills out like this. As this liquid hits the ground, it's kind of like oil, which is already a light. It explodes. Fire plumes up and then it goes out. There's another one
can
on
I
the desk.
The I know I can't throw it, but can I just take it in my hand?
The other one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just hold it.
Yeah, no, see what I'll do. These are pink. Probably should have done this before, but I wasn't really. These are pink, but they're not really. These are blue. No, they're not. These are green. These are green flasks. This is an orange flask, because I just spotted this. There's a blue one. blue, blue, blue. And then we'll say there's another green one down here. Like this. There was another blue one on here as well, but that is now in Malkai's possession. So you have the other fire one in your possession. Malkai, what do you want to do? For some reason, Valorous has just run over and thrown one of these things into a hallway. Petrello's screaming that something's flying out as Gondash looks like he's confused and sick. What are you doing there?
I want to look at where the flask that came to me came from.
It's where Valorous is. There's one left. She has it in her hand.
Can I do like a perception or something to see if, like, what flung them? Like, how?
Oh. Yeah, give me a perception check.
On me. Oh boy.
You're not really sure, but in the same way, you sort of look about the room, and there are a handful of different flasks which stand out to you. There are like some, because most everything in this room has evaporated or just is empty through time, whereas these flasks still have stuff in them and they mostly glow in a very light way. So you can make out that some of these flasks have stuff in them, and they seem to be the ones being flung at you. But generally, you have no idea what it is that's launching this thing, these things at you.
Can I just go to towards the green one, like down here?
This one? Yeah. You can head down towards that one, but your action is already done.
Yeah.
The glass in Valris's hands explodes. There is no. Now, give me a dex save with disadvantage.
Okay.
To just be able to, like, quickly fling it away from you. Nah. This thing just explodes in your hands. Fire.
Oh, the book. I shield the book if I can at all. I'm just gonna
shield the book. We'll use the 11 from your dexterity to say that you shield the book mostly as this just fucking thing explodes. Dealing 4 fire damage to you, and then your cloak sets on fire. Your clothes, basically all of your clothes are on fire on your body. So you're on fire right now. Petrello, your turn.
Holy shit. Can I jump up onto this bookshelf?
It's a pretty high bookshelf. It goes basically to the ceiling, so not really, no.
Can I kind of like hang on to one of the shelves, just get up a bit, I guess. It doesn't count as a climb, I just want to like get a good vantage point.
Do you know what? Fuck it. Yeah, you're on top of it. Whatever. I don't care at this point.
And then I want to use
just
my magic stone.
Just kind of crouch down, though. The ceiling is like here.
Yeah, maybe lying down just. And then I want to use my magic stone cantrip to just fire at these flasks up top.
All right.
That's just a case of doing magical sling, right? On my.
Yes. Nice. Yeah. Which one do you want to explode?
Let's go for the right one.
This one explodes, and like the desk and papers underneath it actually like kind of burn and melt away a little bit, like real, like true acid, like alien. Gondash.
Can I notice that Valorous is on fire and go and try and help her put it out?
Yes.
With my winter blanket, I kind of get it and just kind of fucking hit it against her repeatedly.
Okay, yeah. Give me a d20. Give me 2 d20s because you're poisoned, so everything you do is shit.
4.
You come running over with this winter blanket and start to like plume the flames. It doesn't do any like further damage, but it also doesn't put the flames out. You're just not really doing anything to help at this point.
You must be more careful around fire. It is very volatile. You must understand.
Yeah.
Save the book! Save the book!
Valorous, what do you want to do? You're on fire.
First of all, I'm gonna push the book away from me so that it doesn't catch on fire.
Yep, you can throw the book on the ground.
And then I'm gonna drop and roll. I don't have anything.
Okay, give me a d20 as you roll around on the ground. 4 the ground, it's pretty dusty, and like a lot of this dust actually does a lot to put out this fire, and you put it out rolling around on the ground. Give me a d4. take 2 fire damage for the round in which you are on fire, but you're now no longer on fire, and you are prone. Malkai.
Is this a vase here? Vase?
Vase.
Container?
This is like a big keg kind of looking thing. There's loads of like straw in it. Pretty big.
Oh boy. Can I hide behind it? Is there enough space?
Not really, no.
Can I hide under the table desk?
The table where you are?
Or maybe I'm gonna throw. Can I pick up and throw this flask that's like on the desk beside me?
Yeah.
And I want to throw it like between those two.
Alright, give me a perception check.
Oh no.
Jesus.
Alright. You pick the thing up and throw it. Give me a d20 plus. Wait, what are you, a cleric? Just a d20. Just give me a d20.
Oh god.
You throw the damn thing. You throw it. It flies over here. Dung, hits the ground and just rolls. Doesn't even smash. Just rolls one way into the corner. Devastating miss. Do you want to move?
Yeah. Yeah, I want to move like undercover, basically.
One of these flasks needs to launch at someone. Another flask flies at Gondash. It is one of the ones on this shelf here. Give me a dex save with disadvantage.
Disadvantage, as always. Yes, my rolls today, they're on point.
So
good.
You take... Oh, no, you take 3d4. So you take... You take 9 acid damage as this thing smashes into your back and start burning through your shoulder, like one of the aliens has just aliened you. Petrello, what do you want to do?
So this flask that is rolling past me, I obviously didn't see where it came from because I had my back to it. So
it was just really poorly thrown. It was like rolled lightly across the ground.
So it's like still rolling after the 6 seconds that has gone by. Mm-hmm. And I kind of see this as an act of aggression. And I was about to do that. It's like an arrow thing. But like I get my slingshot and I'm following it as it's going. And then I go...
All right, roll to hit.
No.
It might even actually be enough.
Nice.
Meets it.
Do I have to do damage?
Yeah, you do actually. Nice. Yeah, you fire this rock at this little tiny weak pathetic 6 AC flask and it smacks the glass. It shatters. This one, like, there is like an odd green mist that comes out of this one. It's not like the poison gas. It actually takes the form of a human man, and he goes and then disappears into the air, standing around waiting. You guys looking about. Gondash looks like he's about to fall over. No more flasks fly towards you. You've done it.
We did it.
You've done it. Yeah, you don't know what you've done. But the flask stop coming.
I wanna hide under a table. just gonna sit under this table.
Like, I turn around and tell everyone what I just saw. The man coming out of the thing and flying away.
Give me like some sort of intelligence check.
Intelligence. Wait, how do you do an intelligence check?
You can just click on intelligence, or you can use Arcana or something if you want to. If you're proficient in it or whatever.
I'm not. I just do Arcana, fuck it.
Yeah, you have no fucking idea, but that flask was weird. And they stopped coming.
They stopped coming, and that happened. It looked like a man.
Plus 2. No, I have no idea. I don't know.
That's what happened, guys.
it tells us that. Can I roll an Arcana check?
Yeah.
Okay.
I get under the desk with Malachi, please.
Yeah, you two are hiding under the desk. Gondash looks fucked. Valris, like Petrello's explaining to you that he smashed a thing and then like something came out that looked like a human and then the flask stopped coming, but he doesn't know what it means. And you explain to him that no doubt that whatever was in that mist is the remains of the sorcerer who, in probably a questionable attempt to achieve immortality, managed to distill his very spirit of his aged and decrepit body into one of these flasks to try and stay alive. He was obviously still somewhat conscious, intelligent, and malevolent, but the only power that he seemed to have was to be able to sort of move objects around the room, which is why he was like hurling all of these noxious liquids at people.
I see, Varys.
Yeah. That's what she said. NPC'd for a moment. Varys is definitely intelligent enough to work that out.
Yeah. I mean, she's a professor or something.
Yeah.
A very good one.
A very good one.
I'm really wise, though. I should have known.
I'm neither of these things.
Can I go and check out all the other flasks that are still lying around?
Yeah, if you want to take them, you can. And
also, so roll like Arcana to see what they are? If I have any idea?
Yeah, roll me two Arcanas.
Okay.
The first one's for the one you're in front of. This is just a flask of acid. It's just corrosive acid. You can take it if you throw it at someone or throw it at something and it hits them with some sort of like dex check that you're probably the most proficient person to do in here. It'll deal 3d4 of acid. I'll add this to your sheets, whoever takes what and stuff later on, so you can use them as a thing, usable thing later on down the line. But you have a flask of acid.
Cool.
And you went over to the other two as well while everyone is hiding and Petrello is just confused, still trying to work out what's going on.
It looks human. I don't
but I don't understand. And then these ones are poison. So same thing, you can hurl these at things if you want and they'll do. This one's will do 2d4 of damage, so slightly less damage, but they have to take a con save or they'll be poisoned for 10 rounds. Exactly what happened to Thingy-Majiggy. So you have two of those, two flasks of poison, because this is all shit I'll do later on. There's no point doing it now. And Valris took them all, unless you want to give them out.
I think I'm going to hold on to them, because I think I'm the most ranged.
It makes sense for your character.
Petrello, give me a perception check. Gondash and Malachi, give me a perception check.
20.
Wow. Petrello, all the way over here, in this little this basket, which is like way down in the corner, you spy something from your vantage point up there. You can see that there's not just straw in here. Something glistens off of the light in there. Also, underneath this table, Malachi and Gondash are hiding. And there are two more little alembics, little flasks. One of them green, one of them red. Which one do you want?
I want to say red.
Not you.
Oh.
Malachi and Gondash under the table they're under.
I like red. Could I have red?
Yeah.
Yes.
You now have a potion of strength, and I'll deal with that later on.
I need more strength as a sorcerer.
Yeah. I'll give you that later on. The green one is a potion of climbing. You know this because they are labeled, and so you don't need to do any checks. I mean, you might not know exactly what they do, but you can pretty much work it out. So you have a potion of climbing, and you have a potion of strength. And I will add to like the treasure parts of your sheets later on, like what they do and stuff like that for you guys, because I don't want to do it now. And you also have a potion with a small person in it. Petrello sees something across the room. What do you guys do next?
I would like to go over and perceive what's in this basin.
You pull out the thing which is in this, or you don't pull it out. You say you're looking at it?
Yeah, I'm perceiving it. I'd like to roll perception.
All right, instead you pick it up and...
Okay.
Because it's the same. It doesn't matter. It's not scary. You pull it out. It's a glove. It's a gauntlet. Like metal. Let me just real quick...
And it has all these multicolored stones in it.
It has one stone in it. I don't know how you know that. How did you know that? Have we?
Remember that perception?
Wait a second. Now you just wait a second. You've done that thing, haven't you, Zod, where you've gained access to my shit.
I'm hacking you right now. I am Mr. Robot.
So you pick this thing up. It's an iron gauntlet. And it has all these delicately carved, coiled engravings that go all the way around it in a sort of swirling circular pattern. They even go up each individual finger. They're just like little strange patterns. They don't appear to be runes or anything like that. In the center, there is a very small little blue gemstone. Carved into the back of the gemstone is a little small sword. The gemstone's maybe an inch and a half across, and it looks like the gem can be removed and replaced fairly easily. Yeah, that's it. That's all you can investigate it further.
Yeah.
Good grief.
Good grief.
Proclaims Petrello. This is the Gauntlet of Swords. Or at least it is.
Cloak of Swords.
It's the Gauntlet of Swords. And so what this is, and this is another thing that I will add to your sheet later on, unless you want to give it to someone else, it's up to you. Actually, you probably don't want this. It's made of iron, but it's interesting. This is a gauntlet which has five charges, which you can regain 1d4 plus one of these charges after a long rest. While wearing this gauntlet, you have the option to cast the Sword Burst cantrip as an action on your turn with a DC 16 for the saving throw. The components of it are changed on the cantrip from V to M, with the gauntlet being the arcane focus. Sword Burst is a momentary circle of spectral blades that appear around you, so you kind of just boom, all these swords will appear in a 5-foot radius, and they'll deal 1d6 force damage to anything within that range. You're also aware of the fact that if you take this gem out and replace it with one of the other gems which were created for one, for this gauntlet, of which there are two of these gauntlets, so you could wear two. This is like basically the Infinity Gauntlet for kids. It's got one gem in it, and the gem can be replaced, and you'll basically gain a boosted version of like a spell or a cantrip kind of thing that you can cast.
It's different levels of infinity, one could say.
Yeah, it's like somewhere between the Infinity Gauntlet and just anything in Final Fantasy VII that can carry a Materia Stone.
Infinity minus one.
So that's what this is, anyway. And it's so you can do with it what you will. You can keep it to sell, you can give it to one of the others or whatever.
I mean, as long as you're okay with me having a metal thing, I would like to keep this.
Yeah, you can keep it, but you probably won't ever use it. You're a druid. Druids fucking hate metal.
Basically, yeah.
You can keep it to sell.
Right, yeah.
You don't want it on your body.
You'd never use it.
I'm gonna I feel like I need to keep it. Okay.
This is the worst thing. This is why I would never play a druid.
Yeah.
Because someone will hand you the greatest, amazing sword in the world, and you just go, "Well, I guess I'll sell it or give it away." Nope. Like druids.
Not up for this.
A whip.
Maybe you could trade it for a nice whip.
You could gift it to the cleric who obviously uses metal.
You could gift it to anyone else here.
Zod,
or you can keep it and you can sell it for a very tidy profit. Not gonna lie.
You'd barely know us anyway.
There are two of these. There's another one out there. You know what I mean? Maybe that.
I think I'm going to keep it for now, and then maybe sell it later.
All right.
I just want to read what that cantrip does first.
You have it in your pack, so just add to your pack because I'm going to go through it later on, and we'll do this off stream because it's effort. I'll put a gauntlet in your inventory, like properly, so it's like a thing. Because you have on these sheets, there's a section under bio that just says treasures, and I'll probably add anything that's like weird, like a lot of these things are, to that. So that's where that stuff will go. So Zod has the gauntlet. All right. So that one was Karina, and that is Varus, and then that is Gondash. Okay. That doesn't say Gondash. That says Grucknob. I just wrote it so quickly.
It's canon.
His new name is Grucknob. Okay, what do you guys want to do next? Petrello kind of heads over to a barrel and sort of rummages around in it and then turns around.
I want to go back to looking at the books and take as many as I can carry.
Okay.
Actually.
Most of them are about alchemy.
Yeah, I'm going to take the ones that look most like I could use them at all for my field of study, because there's some arcana involved there. So
you can take.
I'm just going to take whatever I can carry.
Take a book which will teach you somewhat how to become proficient in alchemy.
Oh, yeah, that's good, because then I could replicate those. Yeah.
You can make potions and shit and stuff in the downtime. So, but you'll still need, you now, what we'll do, we'll come up with something where in your downtime, you can study alchemy using these books that you've grabbed, like two or three alchemy books, and you just won't pay as much or anything towards that other than time, because normally you have to pay gold to learn a thing, but you don't need that because you can just teach yourself this thing. You've just Rosetta Stoned your way through like an alchemy or whatever.
Yay!
Okay, yeah, so you have a couple of, you can just put an alchemy book, like Book of Alchemy Lore or something like that. And
I'm also gonna pick that other book back up.
And you have the history of Baldur's Gate. What that'll do for you mechanically is if we ever do anything in Baldur's Gate that requires like a history check, you can add proficiencies like expertise, double, triple, whatever you have. Yours is already expertise.
Yeah, it's already expertise.
You add another two.
I get it.
Because it's probably in the book, you know, unless it's a thing you need to know, like on that split second, you can just go, page 86, it says this, and then you have the answer sort of thing. So, you know what I mean?
I mean, I'm going to read the entire book anyway, but, you know.
Yeah. Write it down somewhere.
Yeah.
That.
I don't know if I'm going to carry that book with me everywhere too, because I'm weak.
Yeah. We'll deal with how encumbered you guys become. Soon we're gonna have to deal with encumbrance, I think, on this, because these things are not shit I've made up. Gauntlet of Swords is obviously, but everything else that you collect on these things and are given is just whoever wrote it says you get, and I'm like, yeah, they're gonna be encumbered after like a week. Okay, what do you guys want to do next?
How beat up is Gondash?
I am pretty beat up.
Pretty beat up.
Azul, I've got less than half of my health.
Yeah.
I'm perfectly fine, so we might want to do a more targeted heal on Gondash.
Yeah, no, I'm just gonna bop him on the head and cure wounds on him.
Try not to hurt me.
For 7.
Thank you.
Yeah, where else? Okay.
I'm probably get out.
Climb out of under the desk.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you guys can spend a little while like poring over the things in this room, but there's generally nothing else in here of worth. It's all just completely pointless. It would be just like a waste of carry space to take anything else from here. You probably wouldn't be able to sell anything on.
Places where body could be hidden, because I didn't see Malke.
There's no body in this room. There's like
there's nobody.
There's nothing big enough. Yeah, there's nothing big enough. You guys have been in long enough that there's no like weird trap doors or any like hidden recesses that might lead somewhere.
Can I, like, check out the tiny person in the flask thing?
Yes.
I have.
You're looking for a wizard, and this is a bottle.
Yeah.
So,
just saying. Malachi brings out a wizard in a bottle. inside, there is just a little female with a raven hair and a lithe build. She's got a little green traveling clothes on and a black cloak, and she's got holding a little wand in her hand. Yeah, you can see her. She doesn't look like she looks asleep though. She's like floating around in this thing, but her chest, her tiny little chest, is moving. She's not dead.
Whoa! I think, guys, I think I found her.
Where?
Is this halfling?
Smaller than I expected.
Like quarterling.
It's the wizard.
Is quarterling thing?
No.
No.
That was what's called a joke.
I'm lying again.
Oh, a joke. I see. So what is this? Yeah. This is tiny. How can something so tiny survive?
Magic.
I think it's a spell or something.
I'm going to start looking through the alchemy book to see if there's anything about, you know, preserving people, tiny people in bottles.
Give me D20 plus 2, unless Karina does something insane.
Smash it.
Smash
no.
It wall.
No, and be careful. Like, I would want to maybe like try and remember something.
And like, you start looking through this book, but you just can't be bothered. You just start. You're pretending to read through it, but you're knackered. You're tired. And you're like, yeah, it doesn't really say anything in this book.
Can I try and talk with the dude inside the bottle?
She's asleep.
Oh. No, give me a little tink on the glass just to wake it up.
Yeah. Give me a strength.
You have to roll for
give
that.
Me a strength.
Strength? No.
Oh God. I'm gonna be like, no, just don't.
Tap, 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 nothing happens, and then Malachi pushes you away.
Can I do, like, history or, like, arcana?
What? Yeah.
Something. Which one?
Either. Whichever one you want to do.
Okay.
You're like, oh my god. This one time, I read about a wizard that was trapped in a bottle. And all they did was smash the bottle. And then she got out, and she was free. And you're convinced.
You have to carefully smash the bottle.
You're convinced that if you break the bottle, she'll come out.
I'm gonna just smash it on the floor.
Everyone,
we'll throw it up into the air, and I'll use my slingshot. So like,
are you gonna hit her?
No, I'm very precise with my.
Throwing it against the floor is a good.
Yeah.
The bottle hits the ground and smashes. And everyone go as Malachi does this insane thing that she heard in a child's book at one point. But as you do so, this tiny little figure inside rapidly expands back out to normal size. She's completely dry, though there are some like traces of like little blue liquid, like thick globules of like ooze. After a moment, she sort of opens her eyes, looks around in confusion, springs back, brings out a wand. And then says, where are the Quozzets?
Hello.
Greetings, well met. I'm Petrello. What's your name?
I'm, my name is, Amelia Greyheart. And,
it's Amelia, guys.
Where did you come from?
We found her.
You are the one. We were tasked to find you.
Tasked to find me? What? I've been gone for about a day.
More like 20 years.
Give me a persuasion check.
Who?
You.
Oh, okay. Oh. Well.
She kind of looks at you like a little confused, like, what do you mean it's been, 20 years since what?
Since you were, like, since you walked in here.
She looks at it. I'm literally only 20 years old.
I mean, it's perhaps the bottle has.
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday! Perhaps the bottle has kept you in some kind of status, stasis.
But I've only been in the bottle for a few moments.
Precisely.
But you were asleep, so you probably just slept for 20 years.
She kind of like looks like she's maybe doesn't fully believe you, but she's super confused. She like looks back and says, it's very confusing. And then she like looks towards like the doorway and says, oh, so I suppose you found my adventuring party.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
They died. We did not kill. They already did.
Yes.
They know in Portal like you.
I was running from the Quasit to try and get in here, and then all of a sudden I was here with you now. 20 years, you know, that can't possibly be. Oh, my husband, to be. Oh, I must get back to Neverwinter. And she starts to walk out. Are you going there? I'm going to Neverwinter. Would you like to join me?
An old friend of yours tasked us to find you, actually. Someone you used to travel with. I don't remember his name. Sorry. He was drunk. Human.
Just dwarf-like friend.
Did he claim to not be drunk?
I think he did.
I don't think he was drunk. He was...
He was...
He definitely said he wasn't.
Yes, that sounds like Ulfgar. Oh, I do hope he's okay. And she starts moving out pretty quickly.
He is one with the earth now.
What? Oh, no. He's not died as well. Wait.
No, I think...
He's just sleeping.
It was just an illusion. It's just an illusion,
Oh, of course, yes. He did the weird thing where he just goes into the ground when he's waiting for stuff.
Yes, it is. Very good.
He does that a lot,
I wish to learn.
Okay. He learned that from an earth elemental.
Earth elemental?
Kind of weird.
He just...
Does this bestow him with any sort of powers, or...?
He can sleep underground, that's all.
You think I could learn such magics?
It makes it very safe for him to sleep. You know, if he can just go under the ground instead of sleeping in a tent. I imagine it's rather cold.
I might help us out next time.
A house?
She's walking out as she's saying all this stuff. She's like,
I'm gonna walk with her.
Rushing and confused.
Yeah.
She gets to like each of the bodies, she says, "Oh, would you bring my friend? Oh dear." And she's like looking him over, like, he's very decomposed. That's happened rather quickly, hasn't it? Maybe we could bury them outside.
I mean, if you want to carry them.
No, of course, we must respect the dead. Let us help her.
Do you take a body?
I take a body.
All right, so you pick up...
Probably the halfling.
This one in here was cleric, right? Hang on.
Yeah,
as she walks through, she sort of asks that you take. She says, "This is Thoradin Dawnfist. He was our cleric, and these horrible creatures came out of the dust, and they tore him apart." And she...
Oh yeah, we killed those.
Oh, very well done. Well done, you.
We avenged him.
Very good, very good. You should pat yourself on the back. She makes a quick detour into the room with the water weird and asks that you maybe grab the horrible body. She offers a cloak to wrap him in.
Yeah.
Do you take him?
I take him, yeah.
Can I carry anything?
you can each carry a body.
Okay.
Just drag him along by the cloak.
She says, "That's Darren Flintmore. Oh, terribly, terribly fine fighter. A halfling like yourself." And she looks down at Maokai, and then she hurries out of the room and heads back into the corridor with all the spiders. And as she walks in, she says, "Oh no, all these terrible, terrible spiders." And looks down at the body. "Oh, will you bring my friend Kithri? She was a very, very sly little rogue, always zipping and darting about, firing her little arrows, and then she was stung to death by 1,000 spiders. Terrible, terrible little business."
I can very much relate to that, but I'm just kind of running through the corridor to get out of there. I don't want to die again.
And you all head outside, once you get up and outside again, the storm that was moving in, heading in when you first entered, like maybe 8, 9, 10 hours ago, something like that, You had like 10-hour rest, so probably about half a day has passed. It's pretty dark outside, but the storm has cleared up. It's a fairly clear night, and you get outside, and she's desperately trying to get back. She's hurrying you along, she says, "You just leave the bodies here, and we'll send some people back to hold a funeral for them and collect the bodies. I just didn't want to have to go back down into there, you understand?" And then she's gone again. She's heading off down the road. "Oh, will you come along? Come, I really must get back to my fiancé."
Yes, of course.
I'm going to, like, sad,
isn't it?
Call Cinnamon.
Oh, yeah, Cinnamon comes running out of the forest.
Cinnamon! Hey there!
And you deftly jump up onto the back of Cinnamon. And
I'd like to pat Cinnamon a bit. I'm happy to see Cinnamon.
Yeah, you can,
like,
pat him.
Like, try some... eat... anything.
And you all head down the road back towards Neverwinter after a couple of hours. You get to Neverwinter's gates, and Amelia just runs into the gates, just completely misses, and you're all, "There's a guy, he's out, he's under the grass," and she runs into the gates, desperate to try and find her fiancé, who she left, what she felt was only a day ago, but has been 20 years. Ulfgar appears out of the ground. And says, "All right, how's it going there, lads? You've done it. You've made it. Was that my little wee lassie friend over there?" He looks completely plastered.
Have you been drinking underground?
No, I don't drink. I don't drink no less. It's water. I don't. No.
Have you had water underground?
No, I don't drink. I said I only drink water. I said.
Yeah, have you had... Never mind.
This one's a bit stupid. I see you've returned, my friend here. I'm gonna head into town. He starts wandering back towards the gates. He turns back, brings a pouch back. "Ah, yes, did a great job there." Ah, he throws this pouch and lands at least 25 feet away from you in the distance. Carries on walking back. "I'll see you there. You stay where tavern are you staying at then?" For the record,
the Golden Berry
Dragon.
The Golden Berry Dragon. You're staying at the Golden Berry. In case I ever need this again, the Golden Berry Dragon Inn. And he says, "Listen, I'm gonna go and tell a friend over there that she's, and then I'll come find you, and we'll have a nice glass of water." And he stumbles into the gates as you all try and pick up all the coins which have spilled out around you. So you each get, if you share it equally, 50 gold pieces. And I apologize for rushing you into the very end of this, but I need to go. So
50 gold each, right? 50.
50 gold each, yeah. I was going to give you a bit more time to just wander back to town, but...
I think that's more than we've ever gotten in
Corrie. That's a lot of
money. Yeah, it is. Yeah, because you get 200 gold pieces. You did the job. Ulfgar was pleased, and he heads in to the town trying to catch up with Amelia, who is trying to find her fiancé, as you guys gather up your coin, head into town a little bit dazed, a little bit confused, and then you find... the Golden Berry Dragon Inn, and you each take a nice little bit of little sleepy. There may be even more to this story. There may be not. We'll see. For there is still work to be done if this group ever return as a foursome to Neverwinter. If we see these same four people, We will do a small little spin-off from Wizard in a Bottle, because there is a sort of ending that I think we can do. But if not, if we never see these four together again, then it shall be a random different adventure. a random different adventure. Again, I'm sorry to rush the end thing, but I have to go and do a thing in 15 minutes. Well, I have to do it like now. But I'm starting a, there it is, look, Brotato. I'm starting a, well, actually, no, I'm completing. I don't understand why you're doing this, Brotato, and now is not the time to discuss it, but we're doing part two of the thing we started offline last week on Brotato's stream now. I don't know why. I don't understand why. But that's what's happening. We're doing part two of whatever his thing is called. I play a halfling, monk, ghost, a ghostwise halfling, which is a psychic halfling, scholar, monk, and it's the most confusing character I've ever had to play in my entire life. But I did do a critical hit scissor kick between two bandits last week and kicked both of them in the head and away from me, and it was the best thing that's ever happened in my life.
I'm sold.
Yeah. So if you want to head over to twitch.tv Brotato in about 15 minutes, I guess, it's presuming it's still happening because I've been here and you might have been messaging me, I don't know, then I'm going to be doing that. And that's why we've had to rush off. So any hate mail, please forward to jbrotato for why this was hastily just wrapped up like, and then you guys get back to town and that's the end, bye! But unfortunately, I have to go like right now. Thank you for playing, guys. I'm glad we like completed this thing. If Karina hadn't gone out and gotten drunk earlier on, we probably could have had a little bit more room, wiggle room at the end. But unfortunately, Karina is a struggling alcoholic, and we all completely enable that, and we enjoy
it. Pray for Karina.
Hashtag pray for Karina. Thanks for watching, everyone. What we're gonna do is at some point. I'm going to try and aim for generally regular Saturdays, but I don't really give a fuck if it happens on like a Tuesday. I'm going to just be running more one-shots based on these modules. Usually, I will plan it on a day when I have more time. And it will have a different assortment of people. So this this adventure has ended. If any of these four people come back in any combination with anyone else that plays, then they'll retain these characters. So... you know, like if Zod is in one next week, but the rest of them aren't, and there's three other random people here, it will be Petrello and then other people's characters and stuff. And we'll run another like adventure that will take one, maybe two sessions. I don't know if that makes sense. Does that make sense? That made sense, right?
Good to me, yeah.
Okay, I just feel like I'm rambling.
We already knew the premise, though, so...
Yeah, I know you guys did. So, randomly, we're going to run some... like singular adventures just because it's easier to arrange everybody so we can play, and we're just going to play some more chill games, I think. So thanks you four for playing. I hope it was fun. It was weird for me to play a random like module.
It was fun.
Yeah, it was fun. Yeah,
I feel bad for railroading the bullshit at the end, but I don't think you, I'm sure you don't care that much.
We should have done a third stream just to wrap up everything.
Yeah, the town hour
that we just do at some point
tomorrow night. Just
tomorrow night, just one town hour, where it's like, yeah, just I'll have a whiskey.
Are we doing experience? It's all
out. Yeah, I'm just gonna work it out off stream because I haven't got time. Cool. Like, I'm just gonna sort it out. You've got a fuck ton of experience though. I don't know how much, and you're level 3, so the jump between 3 and 4 is bullshit. So I don't know, but there was a decent amount of experience. I think the next module I find, I'm for you four or whatever most of you four are in, I'm gonna make a little bit more difficult, because I sort of
stuck
to this thing, and it was quite easy, I think.
I almost died way too many times.
Yeah, but you didn't die.
I went down.
Now you've got potions and stuff as well that you can use. So you've got buff potions and things. So.
We have an abundance of potions and spells.
You've got all sorts of potions, yeah. So like, that was one of the reasons I liked this one, because I was like, at the end of this, they could potentially come away with loads of potions. Because minimum you'll get the healing potions, the strength potion, and the other one, the climbing. So, yeah, I don't know. I like it. So hopefully we'll see some of these guys again. Maybe we'll see all four of them again, and we'll just do a town hour. We don't know. Thanks for watching. Good night. Go to Brotato if you want to just see. Well, it's more like an audio based thing, actually. If you want to just chill out and listen to some weird thing. Last week we ended it by finding a load of like fucking, I don't know, it was like dynamite or something. We blew up a wall because we couldn't work out that you had to put, we knew, but our characters couldn't work out how to put an apple on a pressure plate to get through a door. That was a key. The key was put an apple on a thing. It was obvious, but our characters are dumb. And so instead of working out the puzzle, we blew up the wall. And that's the last thing that happened. And it was excellent. So I'm going to go and play that now. Thanks for watching. Love you all.
Enjoy.
Thanks for playing, you people. We'll see some of you soon. We'll see some of you never again, hopefully. Zod. All right, great. Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.